my brain doesn't work most of the time, and I can't describe it any better than that. Like, the things I used to love doing, I can't do anymore because I don't remember how. I so badly want to be who I was pre-COVID, and I try to be that person, and it's just not there.
Rebecca Meyer is one of thousands of coronavirus survivors who are plagued with long-term cognitive health issues associated with COVID-19.
What's really concerning is the vast spectrum of symptoms that fluctuate over time, even neurological and psychological effects.
The severity of these issues and how long they last is still unclear, but that's starting to change. New research shows that the coronavirus may have more wide-ranging effects on the brain than previously thought.
We know that it affects the brain because of some of the symptoms that the patients are reporting. They're reporting memory issues, or they're reporting forgetfulness, they're reporting some brain fog, they're reporting some anxiety, some depression.
Doctors say some patients are also experiencing inattention and symptoms that resemble chronic fatigue syndrome, and that many are reporting them months after initially getting sick.
Patients that oftentimes are in their 20s, 30s, 40s, never had these symptoms before, or if they did, they were mild.
This isn't the first time researchers have seen this. Other viral outbreaks like SARS, MERS, Ebola, H1N1, and the Spanish flu have also caused long-term symptoms related to the nervous system.
We know that from SARS, there were long-term cognitive changes. There are 50 or 100 patients that were able to be followed up, and we saw long-term neuropsychiatric changes, changes in levels of post-exertional fatigue, levels of depression and anxiety, levels of ability to go back to work.
Long-term COVID-19 research is still in its early stages. And right now, scientists still aren't sure how the coronavirus affects neurological functioning. In certain infections, viruses can actually enter the brain. If the brain's immune system reacts, that can lead to swelling, also known as encephalitis. While this can happen with the coronavirus, researchers say it's very rare. Instead, it's more likely that the virus does its damage through an overactive immune response throughout the body. This can also lead to inflammation, which can harm neurons, cells that are essential to cognitive functioning. Here's a closer look at how that happens. The virus that causes COVID-19 usually enters the body through the nose, mouth, or eyes. From there, it can infect the respiratory system, traveling down the trachea to the lungs, where it can enter the bloodstream. To fight off this infection, the body sends a flood of immune system cells and molecules known as cytokines. These cause inflammation, which can make it easier for blood to form clots. When these clots build up, they can prevent oxygen from reaching vital organs, including the brain, which can cause cells to die. In the most severe cases, this can lead to strokes. But it's not just the lack of oxygen that can cause damage. Inflammation can also harm the protective barrier that shields the brain, making the organ more vulnerable.
The brain is protected by something we call the blood-brain barrier. And the blood-brain barrier is not really a physical barrier, but it's a biochemical barrier, and it allows certain things to go in. Cells can go in and out, certain nutrients can go in and out.
The blood-brain barrier does a good job at preventing toxins and pathogens from entering the brain. But new research shows that the coronavirus can infect and disrupt the cells that line the barrier walls. This is called the endothelium. This disruption causes the body's immune system to kick further into overdrive, leading to inflammation in the brain.
Imagine a road that is paved by endothelial cells. And along that road, you have immune cells, like cars, that are rolling along that road. And if a virus or something comes along and destroys that road, the lining, the endothelial cells, and it becomes rough and difficult to ride along, and the immune cells now start bumping along, they become activated and they now start producing all sorts of free radicals and inflammatory factors. That repair process, if it goes on too long, you now have ongoing chronic inflammation. We suspect that that is what happens in the ongoing process of long haulers.
And this isn't the only way that inflammation can attack the nervous system. Cells supporting the olfactory neurons in the nose can also be damaged by the infection. Scientists suspect that when these cells die, patients might experience a loss of taste and smell. Research from other infections shows that inflammatory signals can make their way up nerves into the brain, causing even more inflammation. These are some of the ways that scientists think inflammation can affect the nervous system, and they could explain why so many long-haul patients are experiencing neurological problems. So what does this mean for those with persisting symptoms? Past epidemics offer some clues. Researchers studying the 1918 Spanish flu found that a number of survivors showed symptoms related to Parkinson's decades later. More recently, physicians have reported tremors in a few COVID-19 patients. But much of the research is still in animals.
It may range from some effects that are temporary to some that may be permanent, including loss of certain circuits that may not come back. And those may be associated with things like dementia or motor symptoms, things like Parkinsonism, things like Alzheimer's and other dementias.
But this idea is preliminary.
It's a prediction based on past events where we know that viruses that affect the brain directly or indirectly may have effects. And so we'll have to see. It'll be a matter of time and trying to test it.
Even so, scientists say these findings are an important step forward and that the research could help find answers, not just for COVID-19 patients, but for those with other brain diseases too.
One reason to hope is that I also have seen patients who have recovered within weeks to months. People who may have responded well to some treatment for some underlying associated brain fog symptoms. It seems that the underlying cognitive dysfunction has been improving without any strong, immunomodulatory drugs, for example. The jury is still out.
Hopefully these issues that I'm having and other people, it's not lifelong. That's what we're hoping. It feels like it is right now. It feels like we're going to be sick forever, but we just have to hope that that's not the case.